Welcome to Engineer on Python. This is a Python programming course for engineers. In this video, I will continue to talk about how to use Pandas for data analysis. Before we start, we need to import NumPy as np and import Pandas as pd. Next, we create a DataFrame that will be used throughout this video. The index contains four dates from January 1st, 2018 to January 4th, 2019. The name of this index column is data time. The frequency is 1 day. The data frame has 3 columns. The column names are A, B, and C. The values are a NumPy array. It's 4 rows and 3 columns. Most of the elements are float numbers. 2 cells are empty, so they are denoted by NumPy NaN, not a number. The DataFrame is created by passing these arguments in the DataFrame function. The created DataFrame is df, it's shown here. Now let's calculate the mean of each column. It's done by calling the mean method of the DataFrame with no parameter. The mean of column A is 0.7. The mean of column B is 1. Note that because there are 2 empty elements, they will not be used to calculate the mean. So the mean of these 2 numbers, 1 and 1, is just 1. The mean of column C is 25.7. We can also calculate the mean of each row by passing a number 1 to axis. The mean of the first row is 50.05, the second row is 0.9, and so on. Again, empty cells do not participate in the calculation. I show the data frame df here again. We can apply the NumPy cumulative sum function to this data frame. It will calculate the cumulative sum along each column. So in column A, this is 0.1 plus 1.3, which equals 1.4. This is 0.1 plus 1.3 plus 0.8, which is 2.2, and so on. NaN doesn't participate in the calculation. We can also apply the cumulative sum function to each row by passing a number 1 to axis. This is the result. These calculations are not done in place. I show the data frame df here again. Now I'll try to split the data frame in 2 pieces and put them back together. Let's first split it based on rows. I already talked about this index location function in the previous video. This statement will get the 0th row. The second statement will get the next 2 rows. The last statement will get the last row. We put them back together using Pandas concatenation function. It takes a list. The elements in the list are the 0th row, the first and second rows, and the last row. See the output. It's the whole data frame again. Now let's split it based on columns. This index location statement will get all the elements in the 0th column. The next statement will get all the remaining columns. We still put them back together using Pandas concatenation function. It takes a list. The elements in the list are the 0th column, the first and second columns. Access equals 1, so this time we put these columns side by side instead of on top of each other. See the output. It's the whole data frame again. Next, let's see some examples of data frame grouping. We create a data frame called df3 using this dictionary 3. This dictionary contains 4 keys: day, fruit type, how many pounds are sold, and the profit. The values associated with these keys are 4 lists with strings or integer numbers. The created data frame is shown here. This data frame can be explained like this. Each row can be considered as a single transaction. On Monday, we sold 10 pounds of apples. The profit was $20. On Tuesday, we sold 15 pounds of apples, and the profit was $30. The other 3 lines can be interpreted in the same way. In this statement, we try to group the transactions by day in the data frame and apply the sum function to the resulting group. The result shows there are only 2 groups because all these transactions happened on either Monday or Tuesday. We have 3 transactions on Monday, so 10 plus 50 plus 5, we have sold a total of 65 pounds of apples and bananas combined. 20 plus 25 plus 10, our profit is $55 in total. Similarly, for Tuesday, we sold 55 pounds of fruit, and the total profit is $50. This statement groups the transaction by fruit instead. There are only 2 types of fruit. We sold 30 pounds of apples and 90 pounds of bananas on those days. The profits are $60 and $45 respectively. I show this state frame DF3 again here. This statement groups the transaction first by day and then by fruit. Because in the 0th row, this is Monday apple. In the 1st row, it's also Monday apple. They are exactly the same. So these 2 lines will be combined. All the other lines will not be combined. 10 plus 5 is 15. 20 plus 10 is 30. This is the result. We can stack the data frame using the stack method and show the details of each transaction like they were defined in the dictionary. The stacked information is shown here. This part is the 0th transaction. This is the 1st, 2nd, and so on. We can convert the stacked data frame to the unstacked form by passing a number 1 to this unstack method. This is the original data frame. If we pass a number 0 in this unstack method, the result is the transpose of the original data frame. Rows become columns, and columns become rows. Next, let's see how to apply math operations on data frames. We define a data frame DF1 using a dictionary. The data frame has 3 rows and 2 columns. The elements are all integer numbers. Here in this statement, we calculate the opposite of DF1 and give it to another data frame, DF2. This is the element-wise operation. This is DF2. We change the column names of DF2 from A and B to A and C. Then we add DF2 to DF1. This is the result. For column A, 0 plus 0 is 0. 1 plus negative 1 is 0. 2 plus negative 2 is 0. However, because DF1 doesn't have a column named C, and DF2 doesn't have a column named B, the elements for these 2 columns are still NaN, not a number. This is subtraction. It's still element-wise calculation. There is no problem for column A. The values will also be NaN for columns B and C. Same thing for the multiplication operation and the division operation. One special thing about the division is this first element here. This NaN is the result of 0 divided by 0. The NumPy sine function of DF1 is element-wise operation. This is the result. In this statement, we try to calculate the square root of DF2. The square root of 0 is still 0. However, other elements in DF2 are still negative numbers. So the square roots of these elements are all NaN, not a number. Next, I'll talk about how to read and write CSV and Excel files using Pandas. CSV files contain comma-separated values. They are stored in plain text, so we can open it using Notepad. Let's use the DataFrame DF we created at the beginning of this video as an example. We can save this data frame directly to a CSV file using the toCSV function and give it a name, mydf.csv. After it's done, you should be able to find this file in the same folder as this Jupyter notebook. You can open it in Notepad or the Jupyter editor. Next, we can read the data from this file to a new data frame DF2. The index column is data time. An empty number will be denoted by NaN. Show DF2. It's exactly the same as the original data frame. We can save the data frame directly to the Excel file using the toExcel function and give it a name mydf.xlsx. We also need to specify the sheet name. It's sheet 1. After it's done, you should be able to find this file in the same folder as this Jupyter notebook. We can open it in Microsoft Excel. Next, we can read the data from sheet 1 of this file to DataFrame DF2. The index column is data time. An empty number will be denoted by NaN. Show DF2, it's exactly the same as the original DataFrame. At the end of this video, I will show how to do simple plotting using Pandas DataFrames. Before we start, we need to turn on the Jupyter Notebook renderer so we can see all the plotting results in the browser. We need to import pyplot as plt. After that, we create a data time index. It goes from 0 hours, 0 minutes, and 0 seconds of January 1st, 2018 to the midnight of the same day. The frequency is 30 minutes. This is the data time index we created. Its length is 48. Now we generate a data frame DF using this index. The data frame has 48 rows and 3 columns of random numbers drawn from the standard normal distribution. The column names are A, B, and C. This is the data frame we created. We can directly plot this data frame using df.plot method. We add legend and put it in the best position with least overlapping. Finally, we show this figure. We can see 3 curves represented by 3 different colors. A is blue, B is orange, and C is green. Because they all come from the standard normal distribution, their values are not too far away from zero. Next, we calculate the cumulative sum of each column and give the result to DF2. This output is DF2. We plot DF2 as well. The cumulative values may show some increasing or decreasing trends. They look kind of like stock indexes. Okay, that was the second part of the how to use Pandas for data analysis. The course materials are available on YouTube and GitHub. You can watch the course videos in sequence. If you like this video, please subscribe and share. I'm Yong Wang. Thanks for watching.